This is where we left in the last video, kind of realizing that. Give me a second, microphone here. Yeah, kind of realizing that the difference between the QFT in the inverse QFT is just the direction in which we are rotating, basically, because you can feed both boxes the same type of input, and they would just have the same type of effect. So. If you feed it a single amplitude, like if you feed it something like that, that's just like number 2, for example, it would just unfold it into a superposition. And if you feed it like a 2 here, it's going to do the same, but it's kind of clockwise rotation, exactly. And so, basically what exactly. So that's kind of the end of the last video here. I nevertheless wanted to take a look at inside this box. I still believe that the labeling of QFT and QFT inverse is not here, at least in Quirk, is not the one that is used everywhere else, but so if I open Quirk and I open QFT, and I get rid of these. So this is how this looks like in terms of what Craig labels the QFT. So there's the swapping in here, which, I mean, we did the analysis on this in the previous videos, which basically triggers the proper chain of rotations. And now I wanted to take a look today at the other box to see how would that make the rotations in the opposite direction, basically. So, because it basically should be sort of a mirrored version of that. And if you take a look at so here you've got the version, not this one. QFT. So, QFT. So, okay, but wait a second. So here I see that the example they give is they give a sample where the things rotate counterclockwise. So that QFT must rotate clockwise, right? To get to that state. And the one that rotates clockwise is the QFT inverse. So that's what I mean. That's exactly what I mean. Here they call it QFT. Here, Craig calls it QFT inverse. That's what's confusing. I know it doesn't matter, right? But it shouldn't really matter, but it can be. I mean, for someone who doesn't really, you know, catch the detail right away, it's it can be a problem. So, and so this looks, okay, so this looks basically this way. So it's kind of the mirrored version of this. Here you've got the swaps at the end, and you've got the rotations here, starting with the rotation of minus 90 degrees. Okay, so basically, I mean, all this is doing, so the reason this rotates can't, the reason this rotates counterclockwise is because, but it should rotate clockwise, right? It rotates clockwise. Yeah, okay, but it's now I'm being confused. Clockwise. Is this really clockwise? Or is it really... Because this is doing rotations of negative angles. Hadamard, negative angles. Hadamard, negative angles. Yeah, and then... And then a final swap. So it's the mirrored version of these. But here, the rotations are of positive angles. Ah, a bit of dyslexia right now. Oh yeah, I think because the way Quirk represents this exactly is positive angles go counterclockwise and negative angles go. That's why. So let me clear the circuit, and so what you would do is you would and I'm not so sure if they're using the same here representation of but I think so in terms of like what's the weight of each qubit, but I think so because the QFT inverse it's done like that, which is what Craig calls the QFT basically. That's all I'm saying. So, basically, you would do something like, do we have four qubits? I think we need four qubits. And then you've got like those control rotations, which are basically inverses. So if I clear all quantum Fourier transform, so it should be like we're now going kind of this direction. So it should be Hadamard should be then controlled of like an S minus one, T minus one, etc. etc. Is it like this? Or why does this look like so nice in here? Spinning. Oh no, it's the parameterized Z gate actually. No. Rotates the target by the input A. That's not this. But here it looks really nice, and here it just doesn't look that nice. I mean, okay, maybe because of the minus. I just want to check it. No, why? Next exponent, anyway. I don't know if that's correct. I hope that's correct, but I mean, is that? Does it still work? Why there's why this has a different. Why does this have a different? Yeah, this works. Why does this have a different notation though? How does? Maybe he, this is just a way. Ah, maybe this is just custom gates. Okay. Yeah. Okay, this is just custom gates. I think then. Yeah, whatever. That works. Okay, so. And now we go up basically with Hadamard and we will kind of, you know. So Hadamard and we have a control and then we have like these and then we have another Hadamard and a controlled S minus one and then we have finally another Hadamard. And that's it. No, that's not it because that works for this, but we still need to swap the things. But this swap kind of bothers me a little bit because I don't fully. It's intuitive to me why is it needed here because you need to activate the proper chain of rotations, but it's not fully clear to me why is this needed here. Or it's not intuitive why this is the effect that we want. So that's what I want to basically try to go through. So if you have a... So how are we going to do this? I'm missing still the swaps here. But if you have basically, let's say, and what the actual circuit is. And now let's actually add the swaps. Where is the swap? Is this a swap? No, not there. Am I blind? Swap. Does the swap order matter? It's a question. Could matter. Probably doesn't. Okay, so that's exactly now where we have it. So that's two cycles within the within our precision, like within our amount of squares in here. And it does it clockwise according to visualization. But if I take a look at this right before the swaps, so basically these two basically stay the same. Why is it that we ended up with something like this? So we've basically got that, right? And then, so when we have, when we apply the Hadamard, we're splitting, so we're creating, we're doing the first unfolding. We're applying Hadamard on that element here. So okay, basically what this means really is the hardware here is just gonna be helping us with the basic unfolding. But those control rotations don't do really do anything. I do because that Hadamard basically does trigger a version of it, does put that qubit in superposition. So this means that for a portion of it, that rotation is going to apply. So that's where the rotation is happening. Whereas if you pay attention to these here, the reason these rotations are happening is a bit different, honestly. So here you're triggering the rotations. So you're doing the swapping first, which is more intuitive to me, because then that tells you what part of it, what chain of rotations is triggered. Maybe that's why Craig calls that the QFT and not the inverse, because it seems to be the more intuitive. Whereas here, it's just another way of doing it. Okay, but I get it why other people call this one the inverse QFT. Because if you feed an actual an encoded wave, a phase encoded wave here, you're not going to get the actual frequency directly. That's why. And the point here is that you want to have an analog of what in the classical way you call a QFT, where you basically, the point is you give it a frequency, you give it a phase encoded wave, and it gives you the set of frequencies that it's made of. And so this is rotating here. Now kind of doing the same, and now you have, okay, so you're doing it for that qubit. So by applying the Hadamards one by one, starting from the last wire here, you're basically creating the axial superposition, then you're doing the rotations on. Okay, that Hadamard, when you do that, has already that phase. That's interesting. That's kind of not so obvious to me, but and then you're doing a rotation. That's a not so obvious effect to me. So if you've got that amplitude, basically copies it. That's what Hadamard is doing. And so then you apply rotation, so you're kind of a rotation on the newly generated amplitudes. So you're doubling and rotating, so that's basically what you're doing. And so you're creating that. copying the entire column. Yeah, and then so the last type we're gonna have is that. Okay. But I guess you need to do the swaps at the end because you want to rearrange those rotations. The swaps after me, the swaps bother me a bit. In here, they just somehow bother me. Why there's no rotation happening in here? It's absolutely the same. I'm a bit after the Christmas break. I gotta refresh a little bit of the stuff. I mean, I gotta warm up again. That's what happens when you take a bit of a longer break. But there's two things that bother me. It bothers me the need of having to do a swap in here. That doesn't feel so intuitive in the circuit design of that QFT. If you would just what if you do it, you would just start from the top with 100 words and then you would go down with the rotations. Like in this fashion. At that point, I don't know actually what I'm taking a look at anymore in terms of internally. Because then basically you've got that, and then so this, the same swapping that we, it's really the end of the same effect that I described, I think it was here somewhere in the beginning of the video. This here. Exactly. That's the kind of swapping that's happening. I don't know if you could see that. Full screen, because I put it in full screen, so you know, so it looks like basically this is going here, you know, and stuff like that. So you're doing these swappings to just put it the way you want it, but seems pretty, I don't know, it bothers me. I don't feel comfortable with this. Why does the swapping, I don't feel comfortable with the reason the swap needs to be, I mean, I see why it needs to be done, but it just feels like is there a way to correct for that here? Isn't there a way to actually set up your rotation so you don't have to do the swapping at the end? I mean, it kind of feels like there should be. Here again, it makes sense because you, as I said, can be expressed in terms of contributions. So that number one in here. So if you think about it this way, if you think about it in the way of, you know, you give it a number, and you want the actual wave. That swap makes sense because you want this one to trigger all that chain of rotations in here intuitively. But that, it's... that is a bit cryptic to me. But maybe because I'm taking a look at it from the wrong perspective, and I should take a look at it not with that input, but with an actual wave. And if I take a look at it with an actual wave in here, a phase encoded wave, then it would make more sense. Because that's designed, that function is designed to make wrappings intuitive, not unwrappings. Maybe that's why. Oh yeah, of course. Maybe that's why. If I put in here, say, the wave encoded by these, so I just put a QFT in here. So end up with these. But you want these. So you're swapping. Okay, so maybe that makes more sense. Each of those designed for, because now you're doing the wrappings in here. So you start with these, you apply Hadamard here, so you're basically folding up, because that half, that this half and this half are the same, right? So you're wrapping up and then correcting the rotation where it needs to be corrected, but here it doesn't need to be corrected anywhere. That's it. Because here this, the rotation doesn't really, nothing really happens, it's all zeros in here. Then you apply another Hadamard gate. Here, and then you get... But what... That's interesting. So what tells it where to wrap to the 0 to the 1? So this is what you got. Okay, and then you apply the last rotations. So you basically keep folding until you get to that point. But now the question is, why don't you get for the swaps? It feels like I'm gonna be closer, but it's not that intuitive yet. So swap is important here. Maybe here, maybe there's some bit of an extra explanation in here, but I'll try to figure out. So why are these swaps intuitive? But this seems the right way of looking at it, because that's the purpose of, that fits the purpose of why it's designed. The fact that it works the other way around is just because the whole thing is a rotation. So if you keep rotating, you're kind of, you know, it's like modular, right? So you're kind of like going back and forth. So what you fault, you end up unfolding in the next iteration. So that's just, it's just because of, you know, the mathematics of it and the quantums of it that it works. But that type of input is the one that is supposed to be, is the one that this algorithm is designed for. So it's actually what makes the algorithm more readable intuitively. Okay, but I still want to figure this out. What is the intuition behind these swaps in here at the end? But this makes more sense, because now the first things would, the way you read that is like Hadamard, so you fault. Hadamard, you fault, rotation, you correct, Hadamard, you fault. Whereas here was more like Hadamard, you unfold, and then, yeah, but it's also first Hadamard. Not first swaps, exactly. So you got the first swaps to make sure that you enable the right things in here. Okay. Yeah. Not super happy, but it's not the worst. Think I'm onto something here. Basically, I want to try to figure out these swaps in here. Why do they make sense at all? What's the intuition behind this? But